الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله صلوات الله وسلامه عليه. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله، اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله تعالى، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. Imam al-Bukhari رحمه الله تعالى, he narrated from the great companion حذيفة ابن اليمان رضي الله تعالى عنه, who said that the people used to ask the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم about good things, but I used to ask him about the evil for fear that I may fall into it, for fear that it may overtake me. And once I said, O Messenger of Allah, we were in days of ignorance, we were in ignorance and in evil, and Allah has bestowed upon us this goodness. Will there be any evil after this goodness? And the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said yes. Hudhayfa then said, so I asked, will there be any goodness after that evil? And the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he said yes, but it's going to be tainted with dakhl. And so Hudhayfa asked, and what is this thing which you have mentioned, O Messenger of Allah? He said that there will be people who will lead people according to principles which are not from our way. They are not from my tradition. And you will see their actions and you will disprove of them. You're not going to be pleased with them. And then Hudhayfa radiallahu anhu, he says, I said, will there be any evil after that good? Will there be any evil after that good? And he said, yes, there will be people who will invite others as well to the doors of the hellfire. And whoever accepts their invitation, he will be thrown into the fire of hell. And the hadith continues. But the important point that I want to take from this hadith, my brothers, is that from our religion, from the way of the sunnah, from the way of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is to warn people about evil. And it's not just about enjoining the good. It's also about warning the people about the evil. And this was the way of the companion radiallahu anhu, that he didn't just want to know about the good. Everybody else was asking about the good. He wanted to know about the evil. And when you look at many of the hadith in the sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, talking about the fitan, talking about the trials and the tribulations and the difficulties that are going to come, you find that the narrator of those ahadith is this great companion Hudhayfa radiallahu anhu. And so we only know about many of those things which we do because the companion radiallahu anhu, he was asking about the evil. He wanted to know about the difficulties. It wasn't just all roses. It was about knowing about the trials and the difficulties that are going to come. And so, sticking to this, my brothers, we also need to, as Muslims, we need to open ourselves and open our hearts to learn about the evil as well. To learn about the evil which surrounds us. Many of our Muslims in today's day and age, they can't take it when you speak about something evil. They can't take it when you warn them against something. You warn them against a methodology, or you warn them against a way or a trial. And we only want to hear the good. This is not correct. As Muslims, we also need to know about the evil. And what we need to know, my brothers, is that every single way, every single path to get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is blocked. Every way that you and me can get closer to Allah is blocked. It can't be passed except the way that was taken by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is the only way to get to Allah, meaning the only way to earn the pleasure and the mercy and the reward and the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is why Allah jalla wa ala says in the Quran to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to tell the people, قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ فَاتَّبِعُونِ. Say to the people, if you truly love Allah, then follow me. يُحْبِبُكُمُ اللَّهِ. Allah jalla wa ala, He will love you. وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ. And He will forgive you of your sins as well. وَاللَّهُ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. And Allah jalla wa ala, He is the oft-forgiving, the most merciful. And then Allah says in the next ayah, قُلْ أَطِيعُ اللَّهَ وَالرَّسُولُ. Say to the people, obey Allah and the Messenger as well. Obey Allah and the Messenger. فَإِن تَوَلَّوْا فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُحِبُّ الْكَافِرِينَ. But if they turn away, then indeed Allah jalla wa ala, He doesn't love the disbelievers. Ikhwani fillah. So whoever turns away from the way of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in terms of his aqaid, in terms of his aqeedah, in terms of his beliefs, in terms of his ibadat, in terms of the way that he worships Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in terms of his mu'amalat, in terms of his general dealings, be that business dealings or dealings with his family, his friends, his home, and other than that, whoever turns away from the guidance of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then he hasn't just turned away from the guidance of the Messenger. He has turned away from the path of Allah. He has turned away from the love of Allah. He has turned away from the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so this is a very serious issue. Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, whoever thinks that he can become guided through a guidance or a way other than the way of the Messenger, then upon him is the curse of Allah, the curse of the angels, and the curse of all mankind combined. Where did Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, where did he take this from? He took it from the statement of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which is reported by the Imams Bukhari and Muslim, that he said alayhi salatu wasalam, whoever innovates, or even accommodates an innovator. It's not just about innovating. It's about you accommodating the people of innovation as well. Assisting them, giving them refuge, giving them assistance. So he said, whoever innovates or accommodates an innovator, then upon him is the curse of Allah, the angels and all mankind combined. This is the statement of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That not only is it about innovating, it's about assisting and working with and helping the people of innovation as well. My brothers, it is not possible. It is not possible for any man, regardless of who he is, regardless of his lineage, regardless of his knowledge, regardless of his power or his wealth or his status, it is not possible or permissible for any man to legislate in this religion after Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has passed away. And this is as Allah jalla wa ala, He says, أَنَّهُمْ شُرَكَاءُ شَرَعُوا لَهُمْ مِنَ الدِّينِ مَا لَمْ يَأْذَنْ بِهِ اللَّهِ. Do they have partners? Do they have partners who have legislated in this religion, that which Allah jalla wa ala has not consented to? Meaning after the book of Allah, after the sunnah of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, no man can come and say this is the religion unless he comes with an evidence. Unless he comes with a proof. Ikhwani fillah, this is what we mean when we say all of the paths to Allah are blocked, except what we have an evidence for. And what we don't have an evidence for, then like it who like it who hate it, it becomes an innovation. It becomes a bid'ah. It becomes a religious innovation. Concerning which the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us, مَنْ أَحْدَثَ فِي أَمْرِنَا هَذَا مَا لَيْسَ مِنْهُ فَهُوَ رَدْ. Whoever brings something new into this affair of ours, that which is not from it, is going to be rejected. So if you bring something into this way, into this deen, regardless of who you are, and it's not in accordance with the way of the Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam, it's going to be rejected. But it's not just about bringing in new things as well. It's about مَنْ عَمِلَ عَمَلًا لَيْسَ عَلَيْهِ أَمْرُنَا فَهُوَ رَدْ. Whoever does something and it's not in accordance with the way that we do it, then it's also going to be rejected. And so, إِخْوَانِ فِي اللَّهِ, these are important principles. This is a principle which every single Muslim, he needs to know, and there is no excuse not to know it. That my religion is based on the Book of Allah. That my religion comes from the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and my religion, it comes from what the entire Ummah has consented and has an ijma' upon. Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us that he said, my nation will not gather upon misguidance. So the ijma' of the scholars, the ijma' of the Ummah, the consensus of the Ummah is an evidence in this religion. Because the Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam told us that they're not going to unite and there's not going to be consensus upon misguidance. I want to talk about an innovative methodology, an innovative way, a way which has become prevalent in the Muslim lands and amongst the Muslim societies. And it stems, or it has its roots in this hadith which Imam al-Bukhari narrates from Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu. He said that a group of three men, they came to the house of the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, asking about the worship of the Messenger alayhi salatu wa sallam. Three men came to the houses of the wives of the Messenger of Allah, asking about his worship. And when they were informed about his worship, they considered that their own worship was insufficient. And they said, who are we from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? All of his past and his future sins have been forgiven. Then one of these men, he said, I will offer the prayer throughout the night for the rest of my life. Every single night, the whole night, I'm just going to pray. And then another man, he said, I'm going to fast every single day and I'm not going to break my fast. And then the third man, he came and he said, I will keep away from the women and I will never get married. So one says, I'm not going to sleep at night. I'm going to fast. I'm going to pray and I'm going to pray and I'm going to pray, never going to sleep. The next one comes and he says, I'm not going to break my fast. I'm going to fast perpetually, continuously. The third one comes and says, I'm going to stay away from the women. What was their reason? Their reason was, who are we in front of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? This is what he does, and all of his sins have been forgiven. So we need to go more than that. We need to do more than that. Look at their reasoning. They didn't stop where the sunnah of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stopped. They wanted to go further than the narrations. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he heard about what these men had been saying. And he came to them and he said, are you the same people who say so and so? Are you the people who just said this? He said, by Allah, I am more submissive to Allah. I am more conscious and more fearful of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than you are. Yet I fast and I break my fast. I pray at night and I also sleep. And I also marry women. And then he said, so he who does not follow my sunnah, فَمَنْ رَغِبَ عَنْ سُنَّتِي فَلَيْسَ مِنِّي. So whoever goes against my sunnah, he has nothing to do with me. I am free of him. Ikhwani fillah, some of the scholars, they mentioned this hadith and they said that this was the root of Sufism. This hadith, it indicates and it illustrates the roots and the beginnings and the methodology of this innovative methodology that we have amongst us today, known as Sufism. Going overboard in the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not stopping where the narration stopped, and not turning to the Book of Allah and the Sunnah of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is one narration which we can use to talk about this innovative methodology. Not going overboard. Another narration or other narrations that we can mention, my brothers, is that the Prophet ﷺ, the most beloved deeds to him were which deeds? The deeds which were done regularly, even if they were little. Even if they were little. So the most beloved things to him were the deeds that were done regularly. The key point, even if they were little. We don't need to go overboard. The Prophet ﷺ corrected Zainab radiallahu anha when she used to tie a rope in her room, and when she was praying at night and she would get tired, she would hold on to this rope and she would carry on praying. So she used this rope to keep her upright. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told her, don't do that. When sleep comes over you, then sleep. Until it leaves you, and then wake up and carry on worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam corrected Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu. When he would fast continuously every single day, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam corrected him. So there is moderation in the sunnah. Going overboard is not from the sunnah of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And when we look, my brothers, at the Salaf, the rightly guided predecessors, the earliest generations of the Muslims, we would see that they would turn to the sunnah. They would suffice themselves with the sunnah. They would look and follow and hold on to the narrations of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this is one of the key differences between Ahlul Sunnah and Ahlul Bid'ah. This is one of the key differences, my brothers. There's no middle ground. There is the people of the Sunnah and there is the people of innovation. One of the key differences is that the people of the Sunnah, they go as far as the narrations go and they don't go further than that. As for the people of innovation, then they don't stop at where the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his companions stopped. Rather, they seek to go much, much further than that. So the question comes now, where does this word Sufi, where does this word come from? Where does this word originate from? And the scholars differed over the origins of this name. So some of the scholars, they said it referred to a particular man. And some of the scholars, they said it comes from the word Saf, meaning the rose, the roll. Others from amongst the scholars, they said that it means Suffa, meaning the people of the Suffa, the people who were poor, and so they had to live in the masjid of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In reality, my brothers, it comes from the word Suf, and this is a type of wool. It's a type of cloth which is very, very rough. And the people of Sufism, they used to wear this type of rough cloth to indicate that they were poor, to indicate that they had turned away from the dunya, to indicate that they wanted nothing from this world. And this was how they were known, the Sufi. The one who would wear this type of cloth, this is how he was known. And don't we see it today? If you would go to the darbars and you would go to the shrines and you would go to the mausoleums and you would go to these so-called pious people, you find them wearing old, tatty, rough clothes to illustrate, I want nothing from this dunya. To illustrate that I have no interest in this world. To illustrate that I'm poor, that I am a person of zuhd. This is the legislated staying away from the dunya. The legislated abstinence from this world. So this is the zuhd of the salaf, the zuhd of the rightly guided predecessors versus the Sufism of this misguided group. Ikhwani fillah, some of these people, they came and they took the words of their imams as evidence in the religion. And so were you to come to one of them and were you to say that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said this, then they would say, no, but my imam said that. But such and such a person said that. Until you would find some of them, and they came out with this statement of kufr, and they said that the status of prophecy is in a barzakh, it's in a certain place behind a barrier. But greater than the status of the prophets is the status of the wali. And so they take their awliya, the awliya who are awliya of a shaytan in reality. They say that we are from the awliya, he is a wali. from the awliya of Allah. And so they will follow him blindly. And this is from the ways of the Sufis, and they give his statements more right and more position than the statements of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. They give his statements and his guidance more right and more weight than the way of those companions radiallahu ta'ala anhum. And so, ikhwani fillah, Imam Ahmad rahimahullahu ta'ala, he said concerning zuhd. He said concerning zuhd. What is zuhd? Because some of the people, when you talk to them about Sufism, they come and they say, yes, but the Salaf al-Salih, the righteous predecessors, they used to abstain from the dunya. But we say, no, there is a difference between, like the difference between the heavens and the earth, between the zuhd of the Salaf and Sufism. So Imam Ahmad rahimahullah, he said concerning and defining this abstinence, he said it is to leave off that which Allah made impermissible and to do that which Allah made obligatory. This is how he defines zuhd. That you abstain from your desires, you stay away from your desires. It doesn't mean you need to wear old, tatty, ripped clothes, and it doesn't mean you need to walk around barefoot. It doesn't mean that you need to stay away from your wife. It doesn't mean that, like the beeves and the maulanas, they do 40 days chilla in a cave with the dogs. It doesn't mean this. It means that you stay away from that which Allah has made haram, and you do that which Allah Jalla wa Ala has commanded you to do. Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullahu ta'ala, he said concerning zuhd, he said it is to leave off that which is impermissible and disliked as well, and it is to do that which is obligatory and also recommended. So you're not just doing the bare minimum, you're doing the recommended, the sunnah actions as well. And then he continued and he said, and it is leaving off of excesses in affairs that are permitted. Things that you can do and it's halal for you to do, you don't fall into excess. And ikhwani fillah, what is excess? Excess doesn't mean that you don't wear nice clothes. Excess doesn't mean that you don't smell good. Excess, it means that you don't live beyond your means. And so if you're wealthy and you are rich, then you can enjoy what Allah has blessed you with. But if you are poor, then live amongst your means. So every man, he lives according to his means, and he doesn't fall into excess. Ikhwani fillah, the zuhd of the Salaf, it was revolving around the narrations. A man came to the scholar of hadith, Ibn Khuzaymah rahimahullahu ta'ala, and he said, why don't you write a book about zuhd? Why don't you write a book about this abstinence in this way? Ibn Khuzaymah rahimahullah, may Allah have mercy on him, he replied, he said, I wrote a book about financial transactions in the sunnah. I wrote a book about financial transactions in the sunnah. As if Ibn Khuzaymah was saying to stick to the narrations and stick to the halal and stay away from the haram and learn about how to be a good businessman and what is the permissible transaction, what is the haram transaction. In other words, to stick to the narrations, this is zuhd. And this is why when the man came and said, write a book about zuhd, he said, I wrote a book about financial transactions in the sunnah. Because he knew that the people, when it comes to financial transactions and where we get our money and how we spend our money, we are loose and we don't really have very much care. And so it was as if he was saying, the person who sticks to the sunnah in his financial transactions, this is a zahid. This is a person of zuhd. This is a person who's put his whims and his desires behind the narrations of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And it's exactly as the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam told us, that you leave off that which causes you to doubt. So anything that there is any doubt about, the person, he leaves it off. This is the person of zuhd. The people of Sufism have nothing to do with the zuhd of the Salaf al-Salih. Let's look, ikhwani billah, at what some of the early scholars, they would say about the people of Sufism. So Imam al-Shafi'i, rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, if a person practiced Sufism at the beginning of the day, then he will not reach dhuhr time except as an idiot. If a person practiced Sufism at the beginning of the day, at sunrise, by the time dhuhr time comes to him, he's an idiot. He's lost his senses. And he said, rahimahullah, he said, nobody accompanied the Sufis for 40 days, except that his brain will never return to him. Isn't it odd, subhanallah? He said 40 days. How many times do they go out on Jamaat al-Tabligh? And other than that, 40 days. And Imam al-Shafi is saying, you accompany them for 40 days, your brain will never come back to you. Imam Malik, rahimahullahu ta'ala, he was sat down, and some people, and a man, he came, and he said, oh, Abu Abdullah, this was the kunya of Imam Malik, rahimahullahu ta'ala. He said, we have a people who call themselves the Sufiyya, and they eat a lot. They eat a lot, and they recite a lot of poetry, and then they stand up and they dance. Imam Malik, he said, are they small kids? The man said, no. Imam Malik then questioned, are they madmen? Have they lost their mind? The man said, no. Imam Malik then said, I have never heard any of the people of Al-Islam doing such a thing. I have never heard any of the people of Al-Islam behaving in this way. And then the man, he continued and he said, they eat and then they stand up and then they dance. And some of them are hitting their heads and others are slapping their faces. Imam Malik, he laughed. He laughed and then he stood up and he left and he went into his house. And some of the companions of Malik, rahimahullah, who were sat there, they said to this man, you know, what's wrong with you? They said, we've accompanied Imam Malik for over 30 years. We've never seen him laugh like this. This is how the scholars were, ikhwani fillah. Ibn al-Jawzi, rahimahullah ta'ala, he says, what the ignorant person calls reliance, meaning tawakkul, that is to spend all that one's owns, is not legislated in the religion. This isn't the tawakkul. So in every single part of the religion, ikhwani fillah, they have gone astray. When it comes to the aqa'id, meaning the aqeedah, then they believe in all sorts of crazy things, wahdatul wujud, Allah is in me, Allah is in you, and a'udhu billah, Allah is everywhere. They say that there is no existence except for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They say that there is a hidden knowledge which I cannot get to, you cannot get to, only the awliya, only our pious people sat in the certain places of authority, they have that knowledge. And me and you, we cannot open the Qur'an. We cannot go to the books of hadith. When we come to them with a hadith, your person says this, but the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said this. They say, no, you are not from the awliya of Allah. You don't have the ability to understand this. And the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came to the Arabs, the uneducated, unlettered Bedouin Arabs, and they understood the religion. But subhanallah, only you and your awliya are now understand this religion. Ikhwani fillah, this is a religion. This is a methodology based upon keeping me and you ignorant so that they can continue to take advantage of us. Ibn al-Jawzi, he continued and he said, I saw most of them in confusion. Those of them with good intentions are also not following the mainstream path in most of their affairs. A number of the early ascetics, they wrote various books for their followers that are crammed full of abominations and inauthentic reports in which the authors instruct them with that which is at odds with the Sharia. Ikhwani fillah, this is something which has been spoken about. What we need to know is that the Sufis that we find today walking around holding their tasbihs, as they call them, this is not something new. This is something which is rooted in a methodology which was refuted by the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam himself. This methodology of going overboard, not sticking to the sunnah, not sticking to the narrations. This methodology, my brothers, which is an illness upon illness, disease upon disease. And so it's upon us that we educate ourselves. And it's not a difference of opinion. La wallahi, this is from the people of the sunnah and the people of innovation. And so it's important that we learn about these things so that we don't stay or we don't fall into them like that companion Hudhayfa ibn Yaman radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, he used to do. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Bismillah, alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillah wa ala alihi wa ashabihi wa man wala. I just want to give you 8 very quick pointers about this methodology. So the first of these is that these people, they base their ibadah and their beliefs and their actions on other than the book of Allah and the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They stay away or they do not understand those ahadith which instruct us about the dangers of innovation. And so they do not stop where the book and the sunnah stopped. They continue on and they think that they have other ways of getting closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The next thing is that they base their ibadah based upon love and based upon emotions and feelings. And so you will find one of them saying, when I turn the lights down and I Allahu and I shake from head, it feels good. We say subhanallah. When was feeling ever a judge between right and wrong? Because the Christian in his church, when he calls upon Isa ibn Maryam, he also feels good. But upon us is to stick to the narrations, my brothers. So the first is that they innovate. The second is that they base their whole religion upon feelings and love. So you will hear one of them saying, I am an ashik of the Rasul. I am a lover of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Even though this ishq in the Arabic language is not permissible to use with the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam. It implies a type of sexual attraction. And so it's not permissible to say, I'm an ashik of the Rasul. And if you truly love the Messenger, then you'll follow his sunnah. And so that's the second way. The third way is that they take the words of their imams as evidences in this religion. So you will go to them with evidence after evidence after evidence, but they will come back to you and they will say something like, but such and such a person said, such and such a person said. Abdullah ibn Abbas, or was it Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhumah, he said, I fear that stones will rain down from the sky because I come to you people and I tell you that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, and you people say, but what did Abu Bakr and Umar say? The companion is saying, I fear that stones are going to rain down. Abu Bakr and Umar, their, radiallahu anhum, their view, ikhwani fillah, does it hold the same weight as the view of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? La wallahi. The words of the Messenger, the sunnah of the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam. What about after Abu Bakr and Umar and you follow some crazy madman? Subhanallah. From their signs is that they believe that there is a hidden knowledge. Golden chains of knowledge which me and you, we cannot access. Only their awliya, they have the ability to access this knowledge. And so they keep the people ignorant so that they continue extorting them. The next thing, you will find their books full of fabrications, full of lies, full of falsehoods, lying, weak, fabricated narrations. And they base their entire religion upon this. Other things, my brothers, is that they have no real knowledge. Wallahi, one of our brothers who is a layman, if he was to sit with the greatest of their mashayikh, the layman, he would be able to ruin their mashayikh. Because he would come with Allah says, and the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, so one layman from the people of the sunnah, wallahi, he can annihilate the scholars of the people of innovation. Other things is that you will find these people delving into magic and delving into sorcery. As the Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, he mentions in his book, he says the criterion between the friends of Allah and the friends of the shaytan, he mentions their so-called miracles that they perform, walking on coal and other than that. And he explains how this is just fooling the people to make them believe that he is from the awliya of Allah. And so we see videos now on YouTube, 50,000 people in front of him and he's blowing into a mic and they're all feeling better all of a sudden, subhanallah. This is ignorance, wallahi. And it only stems from not knowing the book and not knowing the sunnah. And finally, my brothers, from their most obvious of signs is their mockery of the people of the sunnah. So when you stand up and you are from the people of the sunnah and you say, I don't want this innovative methodology. I don't want this filthy methodology. I stick to the book and the sunnah. They're going to mock you and they're going to call you names, every name under the sun. But ikhwani fillah, upon us is to follow and not to innovate. And so we ask Allah Jalla wa Ala that He protects us from these filthy methodologies. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He makes us from the people who cling to the book and the sunnah. On that note, my brothers, tomorrow, bi'idhnillahi ta'ala, there is an Urdu conference. And there are some mashayikh, mashallah, some scholars who have come from abroad. I believe it's just in Urdu. Just in Urdu, so inshallah, if you can understand Urdu, and there will be some English reminders as well, and that is tomorrow after Salatul Asr, inshallah. Do your best to attend. Wa jazakumullahu khairan. Aqim salat.